Hi there, I'm Jim Zirin. Welcome back for more conversations. Richard Haass, an old friend, is with us. For two decades, Richard has been the president of the Council on Foreign Relations, penned 13 or more books, and been television's go-to commentator on world affairs and foreign policy. One of Richard's recent books is entitled Foreign Policy Begins at Home. At home, we have trouble. In a recent poll, the overwhelming majority of Americans say the country is headed in the wrong direction. Our Congress seems stymied. Our own Supreme Court has, in the eyes of many, lost its legitimacy as it ignores precedent and principles of judicial restraint to hand down decisions viewed as supremely partisan. How does the gridlock in our democracy affect our foreign policy? Richard will tell us. We're delighted to welcome Richard Haass back to the program.
Great to be back with you, Jim.
Well, it's great to be with you. Now, I've heard many people ask you this question, and we're living in a troubled world, but I'd like to ask you the question, too, because I think it's important. What is keeping you up at night in the field of foreign policy?
So many things that I clearly don't get much sleep. Look, it's a crowded inbox. On one hand, it's going to be three hands. I'll be the three-handed economist here. On one hand, you've got the traditional geopolitical stuff, most pointedly right now, what Russia's doing in Ukraine, but also China, Iran, North Korea. We have, you know, the stuff of geopolitics. Secondly, you've got global issues. We're still contending with a pandemic. We're living with it, but still dying from it. Obviously, climate change, the world's experiencing the hottest summer ever. Other global issues, proliferation, cyber, are insufficiently regulated. And as if all that were not enough, the geopolitics and the global, then what really keeps me up at night is the United States. What's going on here at home, what you just said in your introduction. And the reason is that for what, three quarters of a century, the United States, not unilaterally, but has led partners, allies around the world in dealing with geopolitical challenges, not as well in dealing with global challenges, but we have been central to that effort. But if we are no longer willing or able to play that role, no one should be under any illusions that the world is going to sort itself out by itself. So as bad as things have become, one can imagine it becoming worse. So problems here at home could lead to greater problems abroad. And as we learned, say, with COVID, problems abroad create problems here at home. So I worry about the dynamic that's being established.
Well, do you believe that our gridlock, our deep divisions in the country have only encouraged our adversaries and to take aggressive action?
Well, I do in several ways. One is the Russians. If you're somebody like Vladimir Putin, you look at January 6th, you've got to think that the United States doesn't have the cohesion anymore. I think also from the point of view of our allies, it's unsettling when you look at the wild swings in American foreign policy. You know, both of us are old enough to remember the time, if I'm allowed to use a sports metaphor on your program, where a lot of the game took place within the 40-yard lines. You could have a Democratic president, a Republican president. The pendulum swing from one administration to the other would not be all that great. What they held in common was greater than any differences. You can't say that anymore. The most common question I get asked in my chair at the Council on Foreign Relations is from people coming in and they ask me, what is now the norm and what is the aberration? Was Trump the aberration and Biden's a return to the familiar norm, or just the opposite? Was Trump the new norm? Biden is simply a four-year respite, an aberration, if you will, and then we're going to go back to a future of continued Trumpism. And that uncertainty means that if you're dependent on the United States, you have got to rethink that dependence. And that's what I think is beginning to happen.
So, well, what's the answer to the question? Is Trump the new norm or is Biden the aberration?
It's one of those questions that doesn't have an answer yet. To some extent, we'll have to wait, not simply to see what happens in 2024, 2028, and so forth, but we've got to see with the next generation of Republican and Democratic candidates and ultimately presidents, what is it they bring into the Oval Office in the way of foreign policy? And the reason it's so hard to answer your question is there's no consensus anymore. And I couldn't sit here and tell you with confidence, say, what a President DeSantis would do. Or one could find people on the Democratic side, and I could ask the same question. The presumption of continuity that we had, if you think about, say, from Truman through certainly Bush the father, to some extent through even Obama for all the differences, there is no longer that presumption of continuity.
Well, when Truman was president, we had a conservative senator, Republican, named Arthur Vandenberg, and he famously said, politics ends at the water's edge. Does it no longer end at the water's edge? Is there a Republican, a Democratic way of forging foreign policy and waging foreign policy?
Well, my first reaction is I'm not sure if politics ends anywhere. On either side of the...
But of course, what he meant is what you said, that it's we have to stay within the 40-yard line.
And the foreign policy is too serious and too dangerous to allow domestic political considerations to apply. Now, on one hand, you could say there are some areas of continuity. Both Republicans and Democrats have taken a very tough line on China. I'm hard-pressed to tell you the differences between the Trump administration's policy on China and the Biden administration's policy. Republicans in the Congress have supported the tough measures against Putin after his invasion of Ukraine. Less positively from my point of view, but still noticeable, is that both sides are quite uncomfortable with anything like free trade. We see that at crossing party lines. So I think there's a degree of continuity, but not though because Republicans have set aside the politics. Simply, I think that in these cases they happen to agree. The bigger problem where politics affects foreign policy, you were getting at it, is in our dysfunctionality. The recent problems, say, moving on climate change, that if we can't bridge our differences here at home to get things done, how is it the United States can conceivably lead on climate change if suddenly we simply don't have domestic legislation that would allow us to set an example that would set a high enough standard that to put pressure on others?
Well, even the modest 50% pullback in emissions that Biden advocated, which was has apparently been throttled by Senator Manchin.
Not just Senator Manchin, to be fair, also 50 Republicans. The idea that you would have something like climate change, which would not be able to garner one Republican vote, that to me, much more to me stunning than Senator Manchin's position, given the geography and politics of West Virginia, is the fact that not one of 50 Republicans would support this. And that's not where the Republican Party used to be. And I would think that there ought to be considerable domestic support. God created the heavens and the earth. One has, the biblical injunction that we are stewards, we're custodians of the, of this planet. Plus, look at a lot of the red states. Look at what they're suffering because of climate, whether it's floods or extreme heat or fires. Nobody's immune, and that's why I'm so surprised that there's not even modest Republican support for responsible policy on climate change.
So has it eroded our credibility abroad that you can't get one Republican vote for a modest pullback in emissions?
The short answer is yes. There's going to be the annual international gathering this year, and I think it's December in Egypt. And what's the United States going to say? Listen to what we say, not what we do. That's not a very, based on my diplomatic experience, that's not a terribly persuasive argument. So sure, it ties our hands and it dilutes our influence and moral authority here.
Okay, so let's look at Ukraine. It's more than 100 days since the invasion. Mm-hmm. I mean, is it going to be a 30 years war, or how long is this going to last? Do you see as the course of the war?
It's the right question. It's in some ways already been an 8 years war. If you think of what happened in February of this year, not the start of the war, but the start of the second phase of the war, which began in 2014 with Russian invasion and takeover of Crimea, as well as the eastern regions, the so-called Donbas. So this is now an extension or expansion of Russian aggression against Ukraine. My own view is, yes, we ought to be prepared for an open-ended war. It's not for a lack of possible settlements that you or I could design on the back of an envelope, but I simply can't think of a settlement that would be mutually acceptable to Ukraine and Russia. Ukraine is not about, I believe, to give up its claims to its own territory. 85% or so of Ukrainian people oppose such a concession.
Would that include Crimea?
Yes. Now, I think there's a potential debate about the timing of that, about the status of Crimea. There could be some openings for compromise there. That could be a role for sanctions to influence that rather than military force. And more important, Mr. Putin's not about to stop this war. If he's doing well, as he has been doing relatively in the last month or two, my view is he'll want to continue to see what leverage he can derive from that. If he's doing poorly, he doesn't want to have to face his own people with a defeat. I also believe that Putin thinks the time is on his side, that a war of attrition such as we're seeing favors him. I believe he believes that there's a chance to weaken the support of the West for Ukraine, that maybe by shutting off selective gas supplies, he can get some of the importers of gas to rethink their military help for Ukraine, to rethink some of the sanctions they're applying against Russia. So I would say the smartest or most realistic stance at this point is to prepare for a long war and to ask yourselves, what do we need to do to continue to help Ukraine militarily and economically? What do we need to do to put greater pressure on Russia through sanctions?
You didn't mention the midterm elections, because if Republicans win decisively, Putin may view that as an undermining of Biden's authority and the robustness of the response.
Possibly, but that would be a misreading for two reasons. One is Ukraine has virtually negligible salience as a campaign issue. Americans are going to vote this November on a lot of issues, but not Ukraine, whether it's inflation or gasoline prices or border issues or crime issues or gun issues or abortion issues, what have you. Those are the issues that are going to inform the midterms. It's not going to be Ukraine. Plus, as I think we mentioned, there still is considerable bipartisan support for a robust policy on behalf of Ukraine against Russia. So I don't see this coming up now. It could come up if the war was still going on in 2024. As a backdrop to the presidential election, I think that's quite possible, and we could see a range of views conceivably on both sides of the, particularly if it's not Mr. Biden and whether it's Mr. Trump or not, whether in terms of whether we need some change in our policy. I could expect there'll be some candidates from one or both parties who might say the war has gone on too long and so forth. You know, at some point, war fatigue could set in, but at the moment, I don't see it happening.
Now, Biden has record low approval ratings, but of course they're about the same level as Trudeau's in Canada and Macron's in France. Western leaders don't seem to be very popular with their constituencies. But doesn't he deserve a great deal of credit for what he's done with regard to Ukraine? There's been no escalation in a conflict with a nuclear power, and the sanctions have been certainly effective to some degree, and he's gotten bipartisan support for aid to Ukraine, particularly military aid.
No, I think it's what you say is essentially correct. I think the Biden administration has handled the Ukraine crisis with consistent and smart foreign policy, both in terms of what they're doing, but also in what they're not doing. So I think they get high marks. The biggest problem with the policy at times has been some of the military supplies going, but that seems to be getting ironed out. The biggest weakness is the loophole on sanctions, where the Russians continue to export and make large sums of money from natural gas. And I know work is ongoing about how to accelerate the moment when the Europeans could begin to wean themselves much more from Russian gas. But essentially, the Biden approach to the world, which is an alliance-first approach, has worked here. It's worked here in putting together strengthening NATO, which is now 32 countries with the recent enlargement. It's essentially on the same page. The challenge is to keep it that way. And I think he's also strengthened certain alliance relationships in the so-called Indo-Pacific. That is the essence of the Biden foreign policy, and that has been the best feature of the foreign policy to date.
Well, that's in stark contrast to the America First Trump isolationist approach. So there is a political difference.
Oh, absolutely. There's differences between the foreign policy. Yes, this is a multilateral, this is a more traditional foreign policy. It's not to say they haven't made some big mistakes. I think they make, I would be very critical, as I was on Afghanistan. I think the president put himself in a box by calling Saudi Arabia and the crown prince a pariah. He then had to essentially go there and eat some crow. I think the president makes a mistake by not having a serious international trade policy. So I can go down the list. I think he's made a mistake on Ukraine, just to say one thing, in framing this as a struggle between democracy and authoritarianism. Well, guess what? Most of the world is not democratic, and if we want them to line up with us, we may want to frame it differently. For example, the right of countries not to be invaded. I would think that's a much more, that would be a line that would resonate with more countries than democracy. So I think the administration has made some important mistakes. But by and large, the biggest foreign policy challenge of this administration, which is Russian aggression in Ukraine, they have handled very well.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned Saudi Arabia, and we might shift to the Middle East. We saw the fist bump that was heard around the world. Mm-hmm. Was it a mistake for Biden to have gone in light of the human rights record of the Saudis, including the murder of the journalist, Mr. Khashoggi?
I would argue it was not a mistake. First of all, foreign policy, you often have to deal with unsavory people. FDR did it with Stalin. Churchill, as you remember, said he'd deal with the devil, if that's what it took to defeat Hitler. Even now, we've got to deal with a Chinese leader who has put more than a million Uyghurs, Muslim Chinese citizens, in detention camps. I would say you have to be prepared to deal with a Putin or Kim Jong-un. Now, how you deal with them is a different issue, but the need to deal with unsavory people, that's simply a fact of life. You got to deal with the leaders you have, not the ones you want. Plus, I think it's important to reestablish a dialogue with Saudi Arabia, given the imminence of potentially a crisis with Iran, given our desire to move Saudi Arabia in the direction of greater normalization with Israel, energy issues, Yemen issues. It's a big agenda. Crown Prince could be the leader of Saudi Arabia for half a century. So where I think the president made a mistake, quite honestly, was as a candidate saying these guys are pariahs, we're never going to deal with them. He put himself in a box. Hence, he had to do this trip as a kind of investment in a relationship with Saudi Arabia. But people now need to be patient. Let's see where this relationship is in 1 or 2 years. And in particular, can the United States and Saudi Arabia come up with a common policy on Iran, which is essential both to prevent Iran from gaining nuclear weapons or getting close to it. Also, we want to prevent discourage Saudi Arabia from getting nuclear weapons. We need a strong U.S.-Saudi relationship if the Saudis are going to feel that they don't have to become self-sufficient in their own security vis-a-vis Iran. So I actually think investing in the relationship makes sense, even though it opened the president to a lot of criticism.
Well, when Biden brought up Khashoggi in the meetings, the response of MBS allegedly was, you can't impose your values on another country.
Well, he's going to deny, he supposedly, I wasn't in the meeting, obviously, he denied that he was individually in any way involved. The intelligence community here said he approved the operation. That was in some ways all predictable. We would say he was involved. He would say he wasn't. And the real issue is whether you're prepared to have a relationship with Saudi Arabia that works around that. You can't undo what was done. So either you say what they did was unacceptable and we're never going to have a relationship with this country so long as this guy's in power. That's an option, not one I would recommend. Or you say we disagree profoundly with what happened, but we've got to essentially still work out a relationship with them. We could set some parameters for the future about what would influence that relationship. But it is, I would say, it still is in the American interest to have a dialogue and a working relationship with Saudi Arabia, flaws and all.
Are you encouraged by the fact that the Saudis said they would open up their airspace to Israeli planes?
I am, and I think it's a question of when, not if, the Saudis normalize with Israel. And that will be a big thing. Saudi Arabia is the big Arab prize, quote unquote, out there for the Israelis. And the Saudis will be in a position to barter their normalization with Israel for something for the Palestinians. And I actually think that could potentially unblock what we used to call the peace process. It's too soon now, given that you essentially don't have an Israeli government, you don't have anything like a viable Palestinian leadership. But at some point, the Saudis can and will put normalization with Israel on the table in exchange for some serious movement on the Israeli-Palestinian front, and that could be critical in unblocking what's essentially been something of a frozen conflict.
Now, the major fault line in the Middle East seems to be Iran.
100%.
And Iran was an entity with whom we, under Obama, thought we had a nuclear deal. You were critical of the deal at the time, mm-hmm. I know, and the deal now seems to be off the table. I don't see...
Well, even if it's on the table, big parts of the deal are set to expire pretty soon. So whether it's now or in a couple of years, it's still going to be the same policy conversation. What are we prepared to do vis-a-vis Iran? And I would say what we've got to do is set, if you'll pardon the expression, red lines, limits on what would be tolerable. And then we have to agree with neighbors like Israel and Saudi Arabia what would be those red lines and what would be done if Iran crossed them. But with or without this agreement, that's an inevitable policy debate to be had.
Now, alliances, there seems to be a new relationship that's been forged between Russia and China. There was the BRICS summit recently in Beijing, and none of these non-committed nations denounced Russia about Ukraine. And it seems that Russia's gaining ground among the uncommitted, and so is China. Are you worried about that?
It's telling that a lot of the world hasn't lined up, particularly on sanctions, some because they have special relationships with Russia. India, for example, because it imports so much of its military hardware from Russia. But to me, the more interesting and telling part of it, or worrisome thing, is the Russia-China nexus. But what they agree on is they're both want to protect the personal rule of the leaders, the nature of their political systems. They impose an American-led world, they've created what they call a no-limits relationship, but it has limits. As best I can tell, the Chinese are not providing arms to Russia. They're buying its oil, they're giving it diplomatic support, but there are some limits. And at the end of the day, there's enough differences of what I believe are their respective self-interests that you asked me earlier what keeps me up at night. That relationship is not on the short list of things that keep me up at night.
Okay, so we have China. We have China, which has been aggressive economically, seems to want to make other nations economically dependent on them, if not subservient. We had the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which was designed to rein in China.
Well, we still have it. We're just not a part of it.
We're not a part. We withdrew from it.
We never entered it.
And so now we're left with what? The Quad, which Biden seems to be
developing. We have the Quad and the AUKUS, which are both security relations. We've had the announced but not yet fleshed out so-called Indo-Pacific Economic Framework. We're not quite sure. It might be a poor man's Trans-Pacific Partnership. We'll see what's in it. But I think the most interesting development in the Indo-Pacific is the strengthening of alliance and partner relationships, worried about China, above all Japan. And I believe there's a growing recognition that we have to be both willing and able to come to Taiwan's defense, to deter or, if need be, defend against the Chinese aggression against Taiwan, which would not just have implications for the 22 million people or so who live there, for the semiconductor industry, but also for order in Asia, that if the mainland were allowed to get away with aggression against Taiwan, I believe it would undermine, if not end, important elements of the American alliance and security architecture in Asia. So there's a lot at stake there. And I would think a big challenge for the United States, with Japan, with Australia, with South Korea, and with Taiwan itself, is to strengthen our military capabilities, to essentially persuade this or any future Chinese leadership that to invade or use military force against Taiwan would be a fool's errand. It'd be a bad bet. And we also have to line up these countries as well as the Europeans to be prepared to sanction China. And one of the things, Jim, that worries me is so many countries have allowed themselves to become dependent on China economically, both access to China's market and what they import from China's market, that I worry that China has too much leverage, almost like Russia does on the energy front. I don't want China to have leverage on the economic front. So one of the challenges for the next few years is to reduce the economic leverage that China enjoys over Europe and over our partners in the Indo-Pacific.
Okay, so I have a question for you, Richard Haass, because we've come to the end. Do you think that America can regain its primacy in the world so that you'll feel comfortable about it? And if so, how soon?
That's a tough question. I'm not going to sit here and give you a cheap answer and say, sure, we can. Churchill's old line, to quote him again, that Americans can always be counted on to do the right thing, but only after they've tried everything else. Well, we're still in the trying everything else phase. Will we get around to doing the right thing in terms of healing and our democracy, bridging our differences? I think the jury's out on that. So I'm not going to give you a sanguine answer. All I can say is personally, I've made it for me my biggest commitment. It is what keeps me up at night. It's the subject of my next book about what needs to be done about that. But right now, the greatest national security threat to the United States is not anything we've been talking about. The biggest national security threat to the United States is here at home, and we have got to sort that out.
Meanwhile, the jury is out. So, Richard Haass, thank you so much for coming by. This has been just marvelous. And thank you for coming by. Tune in next week for more conversations. Please visit our website at conversationswithjimzirin.com. And take care, be well, and all the best. I'm Jim Zirin.